the law of diminishing return. And that's a concept I learned actually in college when we were learning how to calculate an organism's energy budget. You know, when you look at a map and a population and, you know, why these animals like to go here for food, you can actually set up calculations on when they're actually going to stop going to this place and go to that place based on availability of food or predators or whatever. Why I'm babbling about this is because there's also a law of diminishing return on how much is invested into unfucking somebody for them or trying to help them and lead them to water. And I don't use those, I don't like to use those words, but at the same time, I too have been on the other end of trying to help people, whether it be staying in their positions, finding a different position in the Air Force, or finding a different position outside of the military. I think a lot of us, some of us have gone through and had to make those decisions and recommendations, and that's real difficult too. The standard that I always had for myself as far as success or failure, as far as that goes, is I would rather err on the side of safety because I don't think everybody needs to be an EOD tech because it only takes certain people there. And I would rather make a difficult decision up front and face the consequences of that. We talked about consequences, rather than passing the buck along, so to speak, or putting the head in the sand, and then something, an individual ends up getting into a situation where it's not even themselves, but it's safety for other people. That's where kind of, that was my guidance on how I made recommendations or decisions. I know, A-Rod, you were mentioning that about, you know, when new officers come in and you were talking about mentoring or help passing along that information. I just kind of wanted to bring that back to you, but that's how I made my decisions and how I looked at plus or minus. I never, as a tech sergeant, I had to be involved in whether people would stay in the military or have to go out and how they would be separated. And this was all during combat and chaos. And I had no, we had no checklists or anything. I had no guidance. The senior NCO for the shop was getting themselves taken care of without saying anything to us. So we had to do what we had to do. That's how we made a decision. That's how I made a few of those decisions. I don't know if that resonates to anybody else here who's had to make tough decisions as well, but I don't think all of those were successes, you know? And the only way that I can reframe those possible failures as successes is that I learn from those and maybe hold myself accountable.
I think for my two cents on circling back on Dan, what you said, like, how do we, the resolution for me, taking a little bit from all of you guys, right? I think that culture plays a big role in it, right? Culture is what we, you know, are exposed to every day. What, you know, and we've kind of hit on this a lot. Society right now is enabling this. You know, I want to be liked. I want to present this image. I want to, right? And there's a lot that reinforces that, like internal self-centric view, which is not conducive necessarily to the stuff we're talking about now. And so obviously culture, like you were saying, you know, what are your core values? What are your, you know, and actually codifying that, like, this is who we are. This is at the core who we are, right? And I think that's really important because then that helps to drive that culture where the team buys in, and then you start kind of like separating, you know, the people that are and you know, personally invested in that versus the ones that are just like, And you are going to have people like that. And that's been a failure for me that I can speak to is that, you know, I always subscribe to the philosophy that everyone has a place on the team, and it's just up to us as leaders to figure out a way to extract that, right? And I always believed in that, but then it did. There are instances where that has really just burned me, because as Bill mentioned, there are people that don't want to be in the team, and they might, they're savvy enough and smart enough to kind of go through the motions and say certain things, but you know, they're going to leave you high and dry, and they're not going to have any, they're going to leave the team high and dry, and they're not going to have any quarrel about that, you know? And so one of the things that has kind of helped me with that is, something that I lean on a lot. I like poetry, and there's a poem by Rudyard Kipling. It's If, and one of the stanzas is, "If all men count on you, but none too much." And that speaks to that, right? Like, you can't just, like Bill said, right? Like, it's egos driven if you think, oh, I can fix everyone. It's got to be a relationship, like kind of the coach and player relationship, right? The player wants to play and he wants to get better, and the coach wants the player to get better. And so that's where that dynamic comes in. But I feel that the culture is where that helps to extract that. Because if the culture is not there, then there's going to be the pockets where the self-centric stuff can exist, and you know, the organization won't grow then, and it won't be a high performing organization, in my opinion.
Yeah, looking at people's motivations has always been something that and I think it that as I've aged and maybe matured, you know, I take a much more, I have a critical eye now. And my current job, you know, I train folks from around the Department of Energy on energy response. It's kind of funny because, you know, I trained people around the Department of Defense on how to, you know, look for radiation. So I seem to be destined for train and equip. But, you know, we would hold a class, and there was always one or two guys that would be like, so can we take full per diem when we're on these trips? What's the overtime? And then I'm like, okay, so now I know your motivation. And do you want to succeed in this mission because it's fulfilling, or are you looking for money? Yeah. Which is totally why I did EOD.
Well, no, that even goes back to the NCOA taught levels of involvement, you know, trying to get through to subordinates and figuring out what motivates them was something that Dan mentioned earlier. And towards the end of my career, that's, I don't know if Brad remembers babbling on it where we were, but I remember discussing doing our own NCO call and discussing the levels of involvement and trying to kind of gauge where people or personalities might be, because then if you get an idea of their personality or their level of involvement and engagement or buy-in or whatever you want to call it, then you can kind of tailor your leadership management method to that individual, if you know, if it can. But you're right, level of involvement is important. Are they here for a paycheck, or are they here for the person to the left and the right of them? And there's a whole lot of involvement in between. So where are they? Those are questions I ask myself, you know, if I'm saying, okay, this person can go down range, or I've told officers that I would never let any of my guys or girls work for them. Probably not the right way to do it, but there it is.
And that was your job to do that. That was the power that we had, was the, and to use it wisely.
So,
go ahead, Brad.
Something we've really been hammering on this pretty good, and I think that's awesome. But you know, talking about NCOA, PME, et cetera, Talk about turds.